If you enjoy Indian curries, golden milk, or even mustard, chances are you've already had turmeric. It's been used for thousands of years for conditions like respiratory problems, blood circulation, and digestive issues, to name a few. And it's the active ingredient in turmeric that gets all of the credit. A natural compound, polyphenol, called curcumin, which has both tremendous antioxidant and anti-inflammatory properties that we can talk about all day. In this video, we'll actually look at its specific use case in blood sugar control with insulin resistance. We will look at how it works, what exactly the research shows us, how much of it to take, as well as some important facts about it that you may have never even heard of. So without further ado, real quick before we get started, hit the like button down below for the YouTube algorithm, subscribe if you like this type of content, and let's get started. Now remember, we've already talked about the role of turmeric for weight loss in this video, which if you haven't watched, I encourage you to watch after this one. I wanted to turn our attention to one of the largest systematic reviews that are out there for this conversation, called Curcumin and Diabetes, which has synthesized over 200 reviews about this connection. A good place to start is really identifying what happens to the curcumin once you ingest it. Well, there are a number of different pathways we can take a look at once it's metabolized and digested. Three pathways that are relevant to this conversation is, number one, the ability of curcumin to increase glucose uptake into skeletal muscle, mediated by improving the expressions of GLUT4 through PLC-PI3K pathway, which, by the way, GLUT4 is important for metformin too, since metformin is known to stimulate GLUT4 translocation. Secondly, improving insulin resistance in muscular tissue through LKB1-AMPK pathway, which we all know how important it is to improve insulin resistance and become insulin sensitive if we want to manage metabolic conditions, not only related to diabetes. And thirdly, how curcuminoids exert glucose-lowering effects by decreasing free fatty acids, according to this double-blind placebo-controlled trial. Yes, there are other pathways involved as well related to hyperglycemia, like its role in pancreatic beta cells, activating the alpha inhibiting nuclear factor kappa B by leptin and adiponectin and all of that, which I can go over in another video if you like. The takeaway here is that the research on this is robust. I wanted to turn our attention to two big hallmarks of this conversation, because this can go on for days. The first being the recent meta-analysis here, which shows us that 17 randomized controlled trials pointing at how turmeric lowered fasting blood glucose and how that also lowered A1C and HOMA-IR, which is a measure of insulin resistance. Because of these findings, the second hallmark comes to no surprise, as we see turmeric being used for PCOS and metabolic syndrome. Since in the recent randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial that looked at 60 women ages 18 to 40 with PCOS and found that curcumin at 500 milligrams a day for 12 weeks showed us something amazing: reduction in weight, fasting glucose, insulin resistance, and improvement in insulin sensitivity, which are all very remarkable. But let's talk about dosing, because it's important to get this one right with all this information. What we know is minimal toxicity of doses up to 8,000 milligrams have been described in humans, and to date, no maximum tolerated dose has been defined. Despite curcumin's apparent poor bioavailability, peak plasma concentration has been identified 1 to 2 hours after a single dose of 4,000 milligrams and higher. Because of the poor bioavailability issues with curcumin, you often find supplements include piperine or bioperine, which might help enhance nutrient absorption and stabilize blood sugar levels. Some reports say that the black pepper can help you absorb it up to 3 times more, which I thought was interesting. But some of the most effective doses appear to range from 1,000 to 2,000 milligrams per day, standardized to 95% curcuminoids. I've left some of my favorite ones for you down below that I'm a big fan of that you could check out as well. All of them are third-party tested and contain no fillers, colors, and are non-GMO, which not every product can say that they have all those things. And lastly, remember, curcumin is lipophilic. It can only dissolve in oils and fats, so the best way to actually take it is with 15 grams of fats or oils. Fatty foods such as eggs and vegetable oils like olive oil are the best to combine it with. But let's say if you're experiencing some side effects with it, common ones being headache, diarrhea, nausea, or yellow stools, an easy way to get around this is to divide the dose into two doses, 8 to 12 hours apart usually. And this can also help to increase absorption as well and keep the level steady in the body. But I'm actually more curious to actually hear from you guys. What are your thoughts on curcumin? Let me know in the comments below. Also, hit the subscribe button too if you found any value in this, and I'll see you on the next one.